This is a cheap pre-built PC that I bought on eBay for around 230 euros shipped. It's a pretty average looking mid-tower with 8 gigs of RAM, an AMD Ryzen CPU, 250 GB SSD, and a very annoying PCU fan. So, why am I even talking about it? Well, for 230 euros, you're getting a powerful 6-core CPU, two M.2 slots, one full-size PCIe slot, support for ECC memory, and get this, the entire system idles at just 16 watts. Wait, what? I thought Ryzen CPUs were supposed to be like super power and efficient at idle. Well, it's a long story. So strap in, and let's get into why this system is probably the perfect base for a budget home server. But first, I would like to tell you about today's sponsor, Brilliant.org. If you want to learn math, computer science, statistics, or machine learning, Brilliant has got you covered, with tons of fun interactive online courses. And personally, I think the interactive part is really important. With Brilliant, you don't just sit there passively listening to a YouTube video or a lecture, but also get to apply what you're learning right then and there. And in my personal opinion, this is the most effective way to learn. And with very clear and straightforward progression system, you can easily track your progress, celebrate your wins, and stay motivated. And if math and computer science are not quite your jam, Brilliant also offers courses on physics, computational biology, quantum computing, and much, much more. So go to brilliant.org/wolfgang and get your free 30-day trial. The first 200 people to sign up with the link will also get a 20% off their annual subscription. So thank you, Brilliant, for sponsoring this video, and now let's get back to our pre-built. So remember how I said that this system has a Ryzen CPU? Well, that was a lie. This is actually a Ryzen APU, a 4650G Pro. APU basically means that it comes with integrated graphics, unlike the regular AM4 chips. And yes, the 4th generation Ryzen APUs are based on the same Zen 2 architecture as the 3rd generation Ryzen CPUs, even though the 5th gen APUs are Zen 3 just like the 5th gen CPUs. Except of course some 5th gen laptop chips, those are still Zen 2. Anyway, the Zen 2 part is critical. With this generation, AMD finally fixed the C-state issue on Linux, which plagued the Zen and Zen Plus CPUs. This bug would make Ryzen systems run unreliably and even crash when running Linux. The solution to that was disabling the power efficiency 6 state, which also pretty much ruined your idle power efficiency. The 4650G performs very similarly to its non-APU brother, Ryzen 5 3600, but somehow it's also way more power efficient. At idle, the 4650G draws 5 watts less, and once you start putting some load on the chips, the gap only widens. During the CPU-Z single-thread benchmark, for example, the 4650G draws 22 watts less than the 3600, all while having better single-thread performance, and that's a huge difference. So what is that dark magic? What makes 4650 so power efficient? Well, it turns out that despite being very similar on paper, the 3600 and the 4650G are quite literally built different. The 3600 uses a chiplet design, which puts the I/O and the CPU cores on two separate dies, whereas the 4650G is a monolith, similar to how AMD designs their laptop chips. And by the way, huge shout out to Freiheraus over... should I pronounce it as Freiheraus or like Freiheraus? Will I be bullied for my German again? And by the way, a huge shout out to Freiheraus over at computerbase.de. He's the one who tested both CPUs with different chipsets. Freiheraus speculates that it's exactly this difference in design that makes 4650G so power efficient at idle, as well as your choice of motherboard, of course. As an added bonus, just like the regular Ryzen chips, the Pro Series APUs also support unregistered ECC memory, if that's something you care about. Unlike the non-APU models though, you will need a Pro chip for that, since the non-Pro APUs don't actually support ECC. Okay, so the Zen 2 Pro APUs don't seem to suffer from the same idle power draw issues as their non-APU brothers. They have full support for unregistered ECC memory. They come with integrated GPUs, which you can use for hardware transcoding in Plex and Jellyfin. And they're actually pretty powerful. So what's the catch? Well, you can't buy them. That's right, AMD has decided that we can't have nice things. So as of now, Renoir and Cezanne APUs are only available through B2B channels, so OEMs, system builders, and so on. Which means that if you want to get your grubby little fingers on, let's say, a 4650G Pro, your options are A. buy from a reseller on eBay or AliExpress for like double the price of a 3600, or B, get a used pre-built office PC like this one right here. And spoiler alert, the latter is a way better option. Now, as I already mentioned in the beginning of this video, I got this Terra system for 230 euros used off of Kleinanzeigen, which is kind of like a German version of Craigslist, but you're a little less likely to get mugged. This machine came with 8GB of dual channel RAM, wow, they finally learned, a 250GB Samsung SATA SSD, an Asus Prime B550MA motherboard, and a 350W non-modular power supply. It also came with an optical drive, which I haven't seen in a long time. The case itself is a typical mid-tower, with very limited options for mounting your hard drives. At the same time, it does have two 5.25-inch bays, and you can get one of these hard drive adapters for relatively cheap. There are also only 3 SATA power connectors on a PSU, but you can also add more by getting a safe Molex to SATA adapter, such as this one. You'll notice that the wires in this adapter are separated by plastic walls in the connector, instead of going directly into the plastic molding. If you see an adapter like this one, where the wires go directly into the plastic, don't buy it, it's not safe to use, and these kinds of adapters can literally cause a house fire. Now let's talk about the motherboard. It's a fairly typical B550MATX board with one full-size PCIe X16 slot, two PCIe X1 slots, and two Gen 4 M.2 slots. Since it's a fairly cheap board, you don't get Wi-Fi, but that's probably not that big of a deal for a home server slash NAS. You also only get 1 gigabit Ethernet and 4 SATA ports, unlike some more expensive boards that come with 2.5 gig Ethernet and 6 SATA ports. Honestly though, for that price, it's hard to complain. You can still have 4 hard drives and 2 SSDs for cash, and if you're building a server on a budget, that's more than enough. The system came pre-installed with Windows 11, and after installing all the newest updates, the total idle power draw at the Windows desktop settled down to around 17.4 watts. Not bad. After that, I decided to boot into an Ubuntu Live CD and look at the C states in PowerTop. Surprisingly, PowerTop reported that the system was only capable of C3, whereas on Windows, the hardware info reported C6. I did some research, and it turns out that the Ryzen CPUs only have 3 C states, C0, C1, and C6, so the system must be going into C6 on Linux as well, and PowerTop just isn't showing it correctly. After unplugging the display and letting the server sit for a while, the power consumption went down to as little as 15.4 watts, but mostly stayed at around 16 watts. But that's with no devices connected to it. In a typical home server scenario, you'll also want to have a few hard drives, a couple of SSDs, and maybe a high-speed networking card. So I took my current home server build and basically transplanted all the storage and PCIe devices into this pre-built system. For comparison, my current build, based on a B150i motherboard and a Chinese Mutant Laptop Xeon CPU, draws around 15.5 watts at idle, with all 3 hard drives in standby mode. And if the phrase Chinese Mutant Laptop Xeon CPU makes you wonder if you're having a stroke right now, check out this video where I install and benchmark this amazing little nugget. I've also used an M.2 SATA controller instead of my PCIe one, but rest assured, it uses the same chipset and should consume about the same amount of power, if not less. That being said, there's obviously no dedicated space for 5 SATA SSDs, so I kinda just put them in the case randomly. And now, moment of truth, how much will it draw? Well, after executing PowerTop Autotune, the total system power draw at idle with hard drive spin down enabled is 30 watts. Not great, not terrible. So I thought, hey, maybe there's a way I could knock it down a few watts by using some software tweaks. I enabled the AMD P-State EPP driver to make the CPU idle lower. I enabled ASPM for all the PCIe devices. I made sure that the C6 state was enabled on the system, and as you can see from my later measurements with a more power efficient PSU, it does make a pretty big difference. But alas, with the stock PSU, 30 watts is pretty much the limit. And looking at the unit, it's really no surprise that it performs so poorly. It doesn't seem to have any kind of efficiency rating like 80, 80 bronze, or 80 silver, so it's safe to assume that it's even less efficient than your typical cheapo 80 bronze unit. And if you thought you'd just be able to buy a more efficient PSU and sell this one to get some of your money back, well, on eBay, this unit seems to go for as little as 11 euros, so in this case, you're kind of getting what you pay for. At the same time, 30 watts is still pretty good. It's nowhere near my Xeon system, which sips as little as 15 watts at idle. That system also costed me way more than 230 euros to build. Nevertheless, let's see if we can bring our consumption down a bit by swapping some of the components. First thing I did was replacing the FSP power supply that the system came with a Corsair RM550X. This reduced the power consumption by 4 watts, bringing us to 26 watts, but also costed me 139 euros extra, which is more than half the price of this system. Corsair RM550X is pretty much the most efficient ATX power supply in the market right now, at least when it comes to lower load efficiency. But as a lot of you guys pointed out in the comments under my last video, it's also been out of stock everywhere for the past few months. So even if you wanted to buy it for a system like that, which by the way you shouldn't, you can't. Thanks Corsair. Another cheaper and more easily available option would be a Piku PCU paired with a laptop power brick. This 160 watt unit can be found for as little as 20 euros, and I've personally used it for a few years with no issues whatsoever. You'll also need a generic laptop power supply with 5.5mm power jack. Those are pretty common and come with a lot of mini PCs, thin clients and so on, and if you're somebody who tinkers with hardware a lot, you might already have one on hand. If you don't, you can also buy one on eBay for as little as 20 euros. One more thing that I want to point out is that if you have more than 2 hard drives and a 65 plus watt CPU, I'd personally recommend going for at least a 120 watt power brick. Even though your system will probably draw less than 30 watts most of the time, the initial spike on boot, with all the hard drives spinning up, might be as much as 80 to 100 watts. One big downside of those power supplies is the fact that they only have one Molex and one SATA connector. That can be solved by using a safe Molex to SATA adapter like the one I showed earlier. I've personally powered 4 7200 RPM hard drives and 4 SSDs off of my single 160 watt unit, and it has never skipped a beat. So at 40 euros extra, 20 for the PCU and 20 more for the laptop power brick, it's a way more budget-friendly deal than the Corsair PCU. And if that seems too janky for you, a friendly reminder that the original power supply that the system came with has no efficiency rating and can be had for 11 euros online. But the real question is, does it make sense financially? Provided you're running the system 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, at the energy price of 40 cents per kilowatt, you're looking at the savings of 17 euros and 52 cents per year, which means that it will take you around 2 years and 3 months to break even. Whether it's worth it for you, well, I guess it would depend on how long you're planning to keep this system, and of course, your energy prices. Another thing we could do to save some more power is replacing our B550 motherboard with a MiniATX A520 board. It's no secret that your motherboard and chipset can have a massive influence on the system power consumption, so I decided to see if we can save some more power by going with a small form factor A520 motherboard. This is an ASRock A520M ITX, which I got used for 86 euros. It has one M.2 slot, one PCIe X16, both Gen 3, and 4 SATA ports. So after swapping out the motherboard and measuring the power draw at idle, we got an impressive saving of around 2 watts, bringing us to 24 watt power consumption at idle. At the price of 86 euros and the power savings of 2 watts, I think it's fair to say that replacing the motherboard is probably not worth it. When it comes to actual performance, this system is very capable. The 4650G has a passmark score of around 16,300, which puts it close to CPUs like i9-9900, i5-11400H, or Apple M1 Pro. Docker containers are not a problem, but that's not surprising. Even my i3-6100 can do that. What my i3-6100 can't do, though, is compile the Linux kernel in under 3 minutes. I mean, that's as good a benchmark as any, right? And sure, in reality, you probably won't be compiling Linux kernels on this system all day long, but I'm kind of struggling to pick good benchmarks for a home server, since none of my use cases are really that resource heavy. So if there's a particular benchmark that you would like me to do on this system, let me know down in the comments. That being said, this system should handle any typical home server task you can throw at it. Game servers, home automation, media streaming, virtualization, and so on. With 12 threads and support for things like hardware virtualization and IOMMU, this build should also work really well as a hypervisor with something like Proxmox or ESXi. One area in which this system kind of falls short though is hardware video transcoding. The 4650G has an integrated Vega GPU, which is supported by VA API, so you will be able to use hardware acceleration in Jellyfin and Plex. But when it comes to the actual performance, I'm getting around 30 FPS while transcoding a 4K HDR HEVC rip of Dune, which is just enough to playback the movie without buffering. For comparison, my 5-year-old Xeon E2176M is able to transcode the same movie at 61 FPS. Now, if you don't do any hardware transcoding at all, that might not even matter to you, but if you do, just keep in mind that the performance is not going to be as good as Intel Quick Sync. So, what do I think about this system? Well, for 230 euros, this pre-built is honestly a great value for a budget home server. It's not particularly pretty, compact, or even easy to build in, but it's also cheap, powerful, power efficient, has plenty of I/O, and can be easily extended and upgraded for your needs. And the best part is that it's not some kind of a unicorn or a once-in-a-lifetime deal that I got lucky with. Here in Germany, I regularly see those 4650G pre-builds for around 250 to 300 euros used. And as companies upgrade to newer systems, we'll probably start seeing more of these machines for even cheaper. The only catch is that if you want to build a Ryzen-based small form factor server from scratch, instead of buying a pre-build, it's not going to be nearly as cost-efficient. Despite AIM4 being a legacy platform, many ATX AIM4 boards are still pretty expensive and rare. B550 boards from Gigabyte and Asus go for as much as 200 euros, even used. That's honestly outrageous. And even though I got my A520 board for 80 euros, that was just pure luck. Most of the time, those boards are sold for 120 to 140 euros. So realistically, if you want a compact build, you're looking at somewhere between 330 to 350 euros for the motherboard plus CPU alone. Which means that for compact builds that don't require a lot of CPU horsepower, my last build with Topton N5105 is probably still going to be a better choice. That motherboard also has 4 2.5 gig Ethernet ports and great support for virtualization, including IOMMU and PCIe pass-through. Speaking of low-power motherboards with embedded CPUs, I'm currently working on a video about ASRock's new N100DC ATX that features an older Lake N processor with only a 6W of TDP, so make sure to subscribe if you don't want to miss that. So that's gonna be for this video, I hope you guys enjoyed it, and as usual I would like to thank my patrons, James Eppington, Kevin Ware, Alessandro Calori, Carlos Benilla, David Love, Jubastica, Robust Dream of Crypto, and everyone else who supports this channel. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.